in his prime, that's gonna be the voltage that's gonna be developed right here after the switch is closed, and what's the prime gonna be? Well, it's gonna be 10, right? Times what? Times what? 50, right? 50 over what? 80, right? And so that's 5/8, 10. What is that? 6 point something? 6.25 volts. Or, that's here. 6.25 volts, the reflection coefficient below is 1/2, right? And the reflection coefficient for the source is equal to -1/4. So now we're gonna go about, and I'm just gonna do the bounce diagram, okay? So take this 6.25, then I have to multiply it by 1/2, so this is gonna be what? That's 3.125. Some people don't like doing it this way, they're just gonna put down the 1 plus gamma there times, but I'm gonna put the numbers in. Then it comes down here, it hits this, and it's divided by 4 and multiplied by negative sign. Can you give me that value?
-0.78125.
Thank you. 8125. Now, this is over here, it hits here. And divide this by 2, and we get about -0.3 something.
Just divide that by 0.390625.
All right, then multiply by negative sign. This is getting to diminishing returns now. You can see where it's going in the hood. If we multiply, just divide that by 4 and get rid of the negative sign, it's just about nothing, right?
0.097656.
All right, you can obviously see it's going down and nothing, right? Right? Now, after that, we're going to get the voltage at the load, right? Or, I mean, at the source. So, what does that say to look like? Versus time, it starts at 0, right? This is 1 nanosecond, 2 nanoseconds, 3 nanoseconds, we'll get the current in a second, 4 nanoseconds, 5 nanoseconds, and so forth, 6 nanoseconds. It starts at what? Now, this is voltage.
At the source line.
It's just 6.25. Y'all follow me? Mm-hmm. So it's at 6.25. Right. How long is it going to stay there? Two time constants, right? So at 2 nanoseconds, what happens then? I have to do what? I have to add this and this concurrent, right? Both of them occur at the same time. Please don't make a mistake and just do this one. It's this and this, so what's that value going to be? I can't tell that one. It's going up.
That's 2.34.
Okay. So it's going to go. All right. Add it to 6.25.
Okay.
Make sure you add it to 6.25. What's it going to?
8.55.
All right. Is that consistent with the answer? 8.5. What was it?
5.9.
8.59 volts. That's going to stay there for how long? 2 nanoseconds, right? So up to 4 nanoseconds, right? Then what happens? I've got to add the -0.390625 and the +0.0975 to that value. What does it go to? Say again?
8.29, 8.3.
It's coming down. So it's about 8.29, right? And it stays there until 6 nanoseconds. At this point, it becomes diminishing returns. Where is it going to go in the limit? What is this thing asymptotically going to approach after time goes to infinity?
8.29.
And what they're saying, make sure you see this. Now you get rid of the transmission line. It doesn't exist. Just take the 150 and put it here. What are you going to get? 150 over 150 plus 30 or 180 times 10. And that goes to
8.333?
All right. So somewhere out here, it's eventually going to go to 8.33 volts. And that's the bounce diagram. Now, he asked about the current. Please pay attention to this. This is the one people will mess up. To get the current, the only thing we want is to focus on, here's the actual value of the voltage here. That's it. Once we have the voltage here, we divide by 30 ohms and we have the current. Y'all follow me on that? So what's the voltage here gonna be between 0 and 2 nanosecond? Well, you've got 6.25 volts developed here, right? Subtract that from 10, or 10 minus 6.25 divided by, and I'll do the current diagram right below it.
How about X?
Maybe I'll do it right here. And I hope you follow this one. So, when you look at this, for the current diagram, I start with 10 volts here, I subtract that 6.25 and I divide it by 30. So it should come in right here at 10 minus 6.25 divided by 30.
0.25 milli.
0.25
milli? 0.125 milli. 125.
125 milli. 125 milliamps?
Yes.
Thank you. And stays there for how long? Just go with your
10 seconds.
For 2, right? Out to 2, and then what happens? Then I take this and I subtract it from 10. Do y'all follow it? So take 10 minus that 8.59 from 10 and divide it by 30. What does it go to?
47.
All right. Now, that is the current that's being added right now. And I'll tell you what's happening. So it goes to 47 milliamps. It stays there until you hit
4,
right? And then after that, what happens?
10 minus 8.29.
Then you have to take 10 minus whatever it is, 8.29. And then I got a question for you at the end. And it's going to go up a little. Sorry. It goes down, doesn't it?
It goes up.
Oh, it goes up because it's 10 minus that. So where does it go?
57 milliamps.
All right. We'll stop there. Do you all follow the progression? Now, where is it asymptotically going to go to? What's the value as t goes to infinity? It's what? The current's going to be just 10 divided by what? 180, is it?
Yeah.
Follow me on that? It's just a series resistance at that point. Yeah. That's where the current's going to in the limit. But please understand, this kind of a bounce diagram is important for one reason. When you deal with digital circuitry, what we're actually going to do probably for a lot of the digital circuits, you're going to see a capacitor there instead of this. And remember, we covered the capacitance. Instead of having something that's respond all the time, you'll actually have pulses here, short duration. And then you have to get the time signature, basically, of the voltage waveform at the load. And the thing about it is, when you have like trapezoidal pulses, like we talked about in EMC, that's when things can get real problematic at that end. If the capacitance is too large, it'll basically never allow the voltage to get high enough to turn on the CMOS circuit. And that's what you gotta watch. If the pulse duration is too small. Okay. You all with me on that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, any other questions? About the whole, you all follow me? Okay. I wanted to just mention something. We got a fairly good showing here of MATLAB. A lot of people, I know over break I'm going to get all these questions, one after another, about MATLAB. So what I figured is I'd spend about 5-10 minutes talking about MATLAB, trying to answer any questions you have, right? And I'm going to try to actually slap up, do this. I mean, unless you have, do you have any other questions about any of the homework or anything like that? Because it's pretty self-evident how to do these problems. If you've actually done the homework and come to class, there's nothing really mysterious. But by the same token, I know things can get really confusing at times. I'll put that down 1 second. I just want to make sure. Probably have have student copies. My copy is using a FlexLM license, which means I got to get something from a license server. I think it's delta.eng.auburn.edu. And at times it can be problematic. I'm just going to see if this is working. This is the MATLAB project, and I gave you, I gave you a script in here. Here's how I do these scripts, and I'll answer any questions, but I'm going to tell you right off the bat, what I always put down is I put close all, clear all, and then CLC. Now, the only thing that that does is starts it with a blank sheet, basically. Now, you don't have, there's probably one single command nowadays that does this. This is from 15, 20 years ago. It was a little sort of a legacy one. After that, any constants that you want, I put up top. So I'm trying to actually copy that thing from here, and unfortunately, is it going to allow me to? I don't think. Maybe. What's that?
You have to double click the Word file and open it by Word to have a copy.
Double click this file.
On the very top.
Some redundancy here. So let's see what this looks like running the first time. Thank you. control this, I think I'm forgetting what this.
I think if you go and just get rid of the one and two, I think it will automatically open the new figure without specifying. I might be wrong.
This is another, this was done in MATLAB, the version I have at home on my, but this should not be a problem. This should be polar, this should just be a polar here. And it's saying that that's not a command.
I think if you just take figure out, it should automatically generate the figure for you without having to specify.
Yeah, but the problem is it will overwrite itself exactly. What I'm going to do is comment this bottom out. I'm not sure what polar should get. What's going on here? This is the latest version.
This is plot. It's polar plot.
Is it now polar plot? Now, it wasn't on the old version, but it might be. All right, let's see. All right, so we'll give it a shot.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's not pausing very much, is it? Let me do those. Pause. One. One. All right. What the thing is, this is, you see how the axis is rescaling itself? There's a way to fix that, and you'd have to specify the axis limit so it doesn't change. But really, what's really happening is this is showing you how the beam stands. And I'm going to do it for one, four, that should slow it down enough. And you can see the scanning, and right here is when the thing starts breaking down because it's going into the actual null, where it basically becomes almost zero. But that's showing the scanning, so that's the actual scanning of the ray. If I fix these outer limits so they didn't change, you would see the beam scanning around. Then, on this one, come on. Now, if you take a look, and I'm just going to comment off that, like that. By the way, these, whenever you put in percentage sign, that's a comment. It gets rid of that, that will not execute that part of the function, and it green turns green. All right, now this is the voltage versus time. Come on, what now? I can just put V here, probably. Sure, it should work. Yeah, it is. Did I have copy that thing?
No.
Did anybody run this plot at all? I sent it to you after I ran. Here's what it comes down to, how do you get V for this one? You're going to have the reflected power from that. You're going to have to calculate the reflected power. That was the beam signature. Then you have to get the reflected power versus time incident on the antenna. V then you have to go ahead and say that that dereflected translates into a V-open circuit. Remember how to do that? After you get that, it's four times the actual radiation resistance times the actual incident power density, the open circuit voltage. Then you take that open circuit voltage and you put it in series with the radiation resistance and the load resistance to get the actual voltage versus time signature. I'm sorry about this thing. I thought it was the whole, I thought I ran that and plugged in the whole thing, but apparently I didn't. Anyway, for this type of stuff, the real thing you have to know is when you're doing something like this in MATLAB, I usually tell people to do a flow chart first of what you want to do in each part. Then after that, anytime you have something where it's going to be recursive, you can use a for loop to do that if you want, and you can really embed two for loops there in these projects. Has anybody taken a shot at this project, by the way? Not yet? All right. I've given you, in essence, everything you need for the actual signature to get the power density. It's actually going to be rotating around there. Then you have to put the location of the object versus time, and you have to get the actual, basically you have to get the return power density as this thing's rotating from the target for all time, and then you can do the rest of the project. Are there any questions about this? I'm sorry. Let me ask you this. All right, for this, if I wanted to create, that might have been the reason. This thing, what I'm looking for, I need to find actually a power density that's going to be on that target for any time. So I have to find out, since it's an array, you have to have this array factor that's going to be incrementing with this timer at different points in time to get the actual value of the power density. This is just F. You have to multiply the transmit this by the transmitted power density, and you have to take into account the value of R that's changing. This is not going to go well unless I have this. So, what? Turn on the lights. Here's what I need to do. Basically, here we have an array. I'm just going to show it this way. And this thing's going to have an actual power density signature that's rotating versus time. So the beam's rotating. Now you have a plane, and this thing's flying this way at a given velocity. So you need an equation for the location of that plane at any point in time. And then you have to get an equation for the power density along that path. Versus time. Now this is rotating, so the power density is going to go up, come down, go up, come down. And I did show you a sketch of that. I don't know if you realize that. On there, there is something about the actual power density that would be on a plane and return power density. Did anybody look at that at all? Okay. That's the thing I'm looking for. So you have to write this equation carefully, And you have to find out what the power density from this rotating beam is going to be there at, on at, for all time. Then from that, you find the power reflected back here. And that's really just cross-section, radar cross-section times the power density. But remember, that this distance r is going to be changing versus time. And that's something you have to keep in mind. Because the closer this plane gets to the actual array antenna, the larger the reflected power. So you're going to get bigger and bigger spikes. Then as it flies past, it'll go smaller and smaller. And that you should have seen in that in the stuff I provided for you. That I know I'm putting in. But I'll make sure I get the whole thing for you. So just watch out for that. You need an equation for the location of this at any point in time. And then you have to find the power density at that location for any point in time. Then you can get the reflected power back from there. You all with me? So in MATLAB, just use for loops for this thing. That's the easiest way. And that little pause button I have in there, the pause thing, that just tells you how much time is going to go by for each pass through the for loop. So it'll pause for like a fourth of a second or 4/10 of, or 4/100 of a second or whatever you want. I think this will be enough. It'll be challenging, but it won't be overwhelming. I believe you can do this. All right, now, with that in mind, let me go ahead and give you a quiz. Last day of class, turn it in class. And make sure you put that signature down there. There's a
just a printout of our code?
Yes. You need to get a printout of your program and the actual plots that I want.
Thank you.